What does it mean to be the first woman three-star general in the U.S. Army? Retired Lieutenant General Claudia Kennedy is uniquely qualified to answer that question. She'll discuss it next on Global Perspectives.
This is Global Perspectives with Pulitzer Prize-winning commentator John Bersia.
Welcome to Global Perspectives. Tackling complex and challenging issues is routine for retired Lieutenant General Claudia Kennedy. As the first woman three-star general in the U.S. Army, she's also accustomed to breaking barriers.
Hello, Claudia. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, John.
Tell us about life at the beginning. Before you were the three-star general, were you thinking about the U.S. military or were you thinking about something else?
Well, let's see. Life at the beginning was an Army child traveling around with a father who made a career of the Army. So my mother and my three siblings and I, of course, were assigned with him to places like Germany and Israel. So we had a typical Army family life. And then in college, I decided to join the Army. I thought it would be for about 2 years, and it ended up 32 years.
Mm-hmm. So did you anticipate rising this high? I know the Army, all of the military branches are challenging, period, but especially challenging for women at the time you were coming up through the system in particular. What did you think? Did you just set your eyes on the prize and aimed for it, or?
It's the sort of thing that when I was first in the Army, my main goal was to stay out of the way of the drill sergeant, you know? I just wanted to get through training, and but I enjoyed it. I loved it. I did not think about future positions. I did think about what kind of career path there might be, but I certainly didn't think beyond the next 1 or 2 years when I was very young. And as I grew more mature and I really did settle into the idea I'd stay at least 20 years, then you become a little bit more strategic.
Did you anticipate three-star?
No. When I first came in the Army, women really were not routinely promoted beyond lieutenant colonel. And full colonel, which is the rank above lieutenant colonel, there were only three women in the Women's Army Corps that were full colonels. When they finished the job that they were in, they went back to being lieutenant colonels.
Hmm.
And so it wasn't until I'd been in the Army several years that the first woman was promoted from colonel to brigadier general. That happened for the Women's Army Corps and the Army Nurse Corps, as well as for the other services. And then over time, opportunities expanded. But when I first came in, lieutenant colonel would have been the far edge of ambition, and really, it was not something I considered.
How important were mentors in assisting your rise?
Well, I think mentors are important whether you're going to rise or not. You know, I really think the mentor's job, to the extent that they identify themselves that way, it goes beyond whether or not you get promoted. It really goes to the notion of helping you understand what you need to do to improve and what you need to do to help others and to kind of help you with your perspectives. I can remember once after a very tough fought battle, really an administrative battle, to get a mess hall for now called a dining facility. Maybe it's called a restaurant now, I don't know, but to try to get a mess hall in a facility that where my soldiers worked and it didn't have a good one. And I worked real hard to get it and at the end got it because of a lot of other people. A general officer said to me, "Now, Colonel Kennedy, when you ask for something, you know that someone else doesn't get it." And, you know, he was just saying, be aware that now you've got this mess hall, but someone else had to close theirs. And I didn't say it to him because you just don't. But these were all people who had mess halls two blocks away, and our soldiers were in an isolated position and could not leave the facility to go get lunch or dinner or breakfast.
Mm-hmm.
Their soldiers worked 8-hour, 9-10-hour days in a regular pattern like any traditional workplace. My soldiers worked 24/7, four shifts, and were in perpetual state of jet lag. And he probably knew that. I mean, I'm sure he knew that fact. I think most people would look at that and say, well, those soldiers are really do need that extra help. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got to add something to the support if you're asking so much more.
It seems like you've been driven mostly by duty and mission mm-hmm. rather than by the next level to which you were rising.
I hope so. That's certainly, you know, you hope that's your value system.
But once you had risen to, mm-hmm. to the level of three-star general, did you have a different perspective? Did you think, maybe I can do more now that I'm in this position?
You mean have a job beyond the immediate?
Yeah.
No, I didn't really think of that. I knew that there were possibilities. In the Army, for military intelligence officers at that time, there were other three-star jobs mm-hmm. in being in charge of certain intelligence agencies, like Defense Intelligence Agency or National Security Agency, and some other positions. But I didn't give that a great deal of thought. I was really focused on about five or six things I wanted to do in Army intelligence for that brief period of only 2 years as the Deputy Chief of Staff of Intelligence.
And once your Army career was finished, what did you think of? Did you have several items on your list of goals? Did you mm-hmm. want to take a break for a while? What was your next step?
Well, I started thinking about retirement about 15 years before I retired, in the sense of, you know, if you have a bad day, you think, huh, I don't know, this may be the day. But I didn't really ever get a real good plan together. What I did was I said to myself, I want to do a lot of different things and get some exposure to life beyond the one I've been living, because I had only a limited understanding of what the business world was or the world of the entrepreneur. I knew certain things I did not want to do. I did not want to try to replicate my life in uniform as a civilian contractor. I did not want to use, I didn't want to play on the past really great life the Army had given me. I wanted to try something different. So when people offered me opportunities to do things, I usually said yes. And of course you get yourself pretty overloaded, you know, and then it's a culling process and see what works and what doesn't.
But you ended up doing some things in your post-Army life that had to do with security mm-hmm. and intelligence and mm-hmm. related areas. Can you talk about some of those, especially work for nonprofit organizations?
Well, I would say that the things I did in various nonprofits had as much as anything to do with national security. And for example, it may sound like an odd connection, but one of the groups I was on the board of advisors for was Opportunity International, which does, it gives loans and grants, provides savings opportunities and insurance opportunities for the extremely poor. And when I say extremely poor, I'm thinking about people who barely get one meal a day. If someone is getting more than one meal a day, they're not part of this program. This is a program that doesn't feed them or house them. What it does is it provides them working capital for the small businesses. And it may be something as simple as the example early on that caught my ear was a man who repaired bicycles in a very simple economy elsewhere. And what he needed more than anything was a little bit of money so that when someone's bicycle broke down, he did not have to ride his bike to a different village, borrow the money from somebody who charged tremendous interest rates, go get the piece, usually a tire, and bring it back. And then as soon as he got paid, run and pay back the loan shark. So by getting the working capital, he was able to cut out all of that time and effort as well as the cost of the money. Now that seems pretty simple. Why couldn't it have happened before? Well, because banks in his country wouldn't let someone like him walk through the door. He had no collateral. Mm-hmm. They wouldn't have given him a loan. They wouldn't let him even come into the lobby of the bank. And this particular group, like several others, has a very good business model, and they have a good way to track it and keep people from stealing, which mm-hmm. is always a concern if you're a donor. So that was kind of one of them. And I believe that microfinance has a linkage to our national security mm-hmm. as well as to global security. Because if you believe the work of a lot of people who have studied this and know a lot more than I do, a strong economy will create greater national security in any country.
No, I think you're right. And, yeah. and the definition of security used to be so much more narrow, but
yes.
when you broaden it, it makes sense. You're talking about economic security. You're talking mm-hmm. about human security. These are yes. vital elements of the overall security picture,
yes.
whether it's global or national. So it makes all the sense in the world.
Yeah. I went to the Dominican Republic with that particular group, a small group of us, and we were driven around in a car by a man who took us from one place to another to see these different very small businesses in operation. And I asked him at some point, well, how did you get connected and how did you get a job as a driver for this group? And he said, well, he grew up in extreme poverty himself. He said, we only had one meal a day. And our strategy was to eat the meal at the beginning of the day so we would have energy to work. And then at night, no, wait a minute, I have it reversed. He said, our strategy was to eat the meal at night so that you could go to sleep. It's harder to go to sleep if you're hungry. In the morning, they didn't eat, they'd go to work. And so that was a distraction throughout the day to manage that real deprivation. Mm-hmm. And you just don't imagine in a land of the land of plenty, in fact, way too much, you don't even imagine the lives of a mother and a father who have more children than they planned for and have a lot that they have to do to make sure they're fed.
Mm-hmm. Tell us about your involvement with the American Security Project.
Well, I love that project. It was started by Senator John Kerry and Senator Chuck Hagel in the days when they were senators. It's a nonpartisan effort, and it's a group that thinks about and encourages others to think about alternatives in our foreign policy. We're not going to just go down one lane or another and think there are only two choices and that they have much more connection with our own politics than anyone thinks is necessary. This is a pretty creative group of people who come from a variety of backgrounds and really try to encourage people in academia to study these matters such as climate change and energy and other policies that affect our national security.
Issues such as climate change mm-hmm. are often manipulated by politicians.
Mm-hmm.
They seem to be understood best by scientists and understood least by the average person. Mm-hmm. How can we get the average person interested in and talking about issues such as climate change, especially in the context of security?
Yeah, I think it's very hard for people to sort out between the hype and the facts. You hear very compelling arguments on every single side, of which there are more than two for most issues. In the climate change world, there's very little disagreement about the reality of it. I think I read recently that one scientist out of 2,300 thought that climate change didn't exist, that he denied the existence of climate change. But when 2,300 other scientists say that they believe it and they have all sorts of data and the studies are widely available now that we have internet, I think then the only question is, are you going to be smart about this and get informed? Or you're at least going to get out of the way and let somebody who is informed deal with it.
How early should people start learning about these kinds of issues? Are they appropriate for elementary school children, for example?
I think so, yeah. Well, who's more affected and who's going to be more affected for the longer period than a six-year-old?
Mm-hmm.
I think you can start children as early as possible because it gives them a subject that's interesting to read about and hopefully discourage some of the wasted time that comes with preoccupations around things that probably have made a lot of money for some elements of our society but aren't really very meaningful. But I think children's interest in climate change can help get them started thinking about science and math, mm-hmm. engineering. It can get them to think about expressions that are much more creative and give them a sense of that if you know more, you have more power. Because what we really need is children who feel powerful. If they're kept in the dark about realities and they're expected to play with things that don't have much basis in reality, that's got to be scary.
And it seems to be in our best interest to encourage students to move in the direction of those fields mm-hmm. anyway. In fact, many school districts already are.
Yes.
It makes sense. And historically, when we haven't been as inclined toward technology and critical languages and things like that, going back to the Soviet period, we saw what happened.
Mm-hmm.
We were overtaken and had to play catch up.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
now we're in a position where the same thing could happen vis-a-vis other countries and cultures.
Well, you know, we have to make it fashionable to be smart.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we do a good job of that for some people. But I'm not sure that we play it up as much as we could. And maybe we've got a better chance, what with all the technology and computers. But it would be very important to help children feel that it's important to learn serious things.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other part of that, of at least equal importance, is to teach them things that relate to character.
When you get outside of the realm of security, what are the issues, political and otherwise, that interest you, that motivate you?
Well, I'm very interested in getting our government to stop torturing people. And although the president, on his second day in office, signed several, I think he signed three executive orders to stop torture and go in the right direction that would be consistent with American values, he's been blocked in doing that by a Congress that perhaps they just don't understand how important this is. But if we really believe we're the land of the free, we need to act like it when we deal with anyone. I have friends that completely disagree with me, and they think that if it takes waterboarding to get information from someone, that why wouldn't you do it? And I say, if you've waterboarded someone 180 times and it hasn't worked, why are you doing it again? But I also say, you shouldn't do it the first 180 times. It doesn't make any sense. Now, there are a lot of reports out there, some of them completely unclassified. Some of them, one of those reports was done by the Constitution Project, of which there was a sub-element, and I took part in it lightly. I can't say I'm their greatest contributor, but it was called the Detainee Treatment Project. They were taking a look at how detainees, particularly at Guantanamo and other facilities, had been treated. Was this constitutional? Was it lawful? What should we do? That's completely unclassified and available on the internet under the Constitution Project. There's another report about to be released by the SSCI, which means Senate Select Committee on Intelligence. It will include material that was only available within government channels, and there's been a great deal of back and forth about what can be released and what has to be cleaned up by a redaction process where they block out things they think might be dangerous in some way, keeping us from having public knowledge of this. But I really don't want to see anyone tortured in my name. And I feel responsible as an American that we have people that are still being detained. There are reasonable things to be done with them, even if they're dangerous. And the money that it would take to make the correct path and the correct decisions for them to keep us safe is much less than it's costing right now to keep them and do all that forced feeding. Mm-hmm. There are men in that prison in Gitmo that have been force-fed for 7 years. Physically, they can't even eat on their own anymore because they've been force-fed so long. And if anyone thinks forced feeding is not painful agony, they don't understand what they've got. People need to pay attention, and we need much more public support for stopping our treatment of people this way.
I know your interest in human rights goes beyond this issue. What are some of the other topics?
Oh, I have another dreary one. It's human trafficking. I just think there's a great documentary that was called Not in My Name, and it's been getting a lot of good circulation. It's on the internet also, Not in My Name, and it's about human trafficking. It starts with an opening scene of a little boy, and it's underwater, and this little boy is among thousands and thousands who are forced to dive under the sea, I believe it's somewhere near the Indian Ocean, and collect up whatever it is. You know, I doubt that it's oysters, but something valuable to someone commercially. It's very dangerous the way they're treated. They're not fed, they're not sheltered, they're not cared for, and they're exploited mercilessly. Human trafficking applies to people who are gathering in crops for free, who are working in terrible conditions in labor situations. There's the sex trafficking, a lot of exploitation, and I just don't understand why that hasn't been more changed. Mm-hmm. There's only one explanation to me for this not changing, and it is that someone's making money And who is it on the side we would think represent us that allows this to go on? I really think we ought to have more discussion about this, because it's like a lot of things. It must be a very well-organized, well-funded effort for so much wrong to keep on happening.
It is well-organized, well-funded, and
yes,
it's global.
Yes, it is. And it's global, and it's happening in our backyard. It's happening in McLean, Virginia. It's happening in Hilton Head Island, South Carolina. It's happening in the Midwest. One of the episodes, one of the segments of Not In My Name is a woman, I believe she was a teenager someplace like Kansas, and she and her friend decided to run away, and then she tells this story. It's hard to understand how a middle-class girl out of a reasonable home, not anything that anyone should be appalled by at all, parents that loved her, a normal home life, and there she is being trafficked among truckers off of the highways. But when you hear the story, you understand how that started, why it continued for so long. And it tells you that we really do need to make sure that girls and boys both understand there are a lot of things they don't have to put up with. And we need to have a way to catch that. You know, I can remember seeing something I thought was probably not just inappropriate, it was probably bad. You try telling that to the police force. I mean, they wouldn't take the report. He said, well, why didn't you call me at the time? And I said, I knew it was something wrong, but I didn't see a crime happening. And because there was no crime that you could see in that narrow window of time of a couple of minutes, he didn't think it was important even to write it up. So there are crimes committed that never even get reported, even though someone has a good intention or has good judgment or is willing to face it. It shouldn't be that way. We should have an easier system. And some of it goes to the question of, if something's a very difficult topic, like most of these are, there's got to be some place in between observing it and the legal system, some place in that space in the middle where people can go without fear of being belittled for what they want to report, but someone responsible helps put that data point in a system that allows us to analyze, hey, have we had about a dozen reports about this guy in this apartment complex insisting this child get in the swimming pool? I mean, that would be kind of a pattern. But if you get a single report of it, it doesn't get you very far.
Right. You have so much interest, so much energy, so much passion. Mm-hmm. What is next for you? I can't imagine that you would ever run out of issues to pursue.
Oh, no. There's an endless supply. Yeah. I think I just continue to try to work on what I see in front of me. It's one of those decisions. I was talking to someone a few minutes ago. Do you work at the tiniest part of something big and important, or do you work on something that you really can't see progress immediately to, but it may not be such a big, it might not be a first priority to people. I'll give you an example. You may want to erase this part. But I love cats. Now, I acknowledge I'm an older woman. I do needlepoint, but yes, I love cats. So we have a pretty bad history with cats where we are. And I think there's something to be said for beginning the day by feeding the hungry cats, trapping the ones that still need to go through the spay-neuter process, releasing them into the place they came from, or making that place more safe by the time you get them back there. That sounds very small. It sounds like a stereotype of something from an Agatha Christie book, but that's good. I think it's good to be able to start the day with something you know is important, finish the day knowing you got it done, and it may not be on anyone's agenda except a couple of men and women that are out there also, but it's getting something done that's important.
Good. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Claudia Kennedy.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you. For Global Perspectives, I'm John Bersia. We'll see you next time.